Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. Richard Fields will be here in a few weeks, and I'm happy to fill in, and it's a privilege to be here. As you know, we're on Access Sacramento. It's Comcast Cable Channel 17. You can watch it on the internet, Channel 17, Thursdays at 8 p.m. It re-airs Fridays at noon and re-airs on Saturdays at 4 a.m. I'm usually up then. I have some outstanding guests with me tonight. I'd like to introduce Keaton to my left, Ken to my right, and Vaughn. Three outstanding young adults from the Placer County area, Roseville, Rockland. And we're here to get some feedback and then some ideas of where we are in the world today. So, gentlemen, welcome to Libertarian Counterpoint.
I'd like to say thanks for having us out and
Thank you.
Being here on Libertarian Counterpoint.
And go ahead and feel free to introduce yourselves a little
I,
bit.
my name's Ken Gillespie. I'm the vice chairman of the Placer County Libertarian Party. I'm also on the executive committee for the California Libertarian Party.
Excellent. All right.
Oh, my name's Vaughn. I've been libertarian for about a year or so. Finally met you guys at a roundtable meeting and
Right.
decided I'd join and start talking to you guys, and here I am.
Welcome. Wonderful. Glad to have you.
My name's Keaton. I've been a libertarian for about a year, and I was introduced to Steve and Ken at a meeting once, and just been going ever since.
Having fun.
Yeah.
All right. Learning stuff. Very good.
So I think we said the topic for this show is going to be it's going to we're going to be talking about the changes that we've seen in America, losses of freedom and maybe gains of freedom in other areas and in our lifetimes and in your lifetime. What's changed?
Well, a lot, and of course, change is constant and inevitable. Some good, some bad. Of course, in the decades that I've been around, used to be able to do a lot of things, and of course, you were responsible for the consequences of things if you did that weren't, let's say, maybe the best choices. But we've seen a lot of restrictions in freedoms in the past couple of decades. And it seems like with your generation, you probably don't notice that as much because it's always been since what, 9/11? Let's talk about that. So, since 9/11, the Unpatriot Act and things like that were just not in our radar, when I was your age. We could do ride motorcycles wherever we wanted, dirt bikes and helmets or no helmets or
You didn't have to worry about any taps
personal
on your phone
freedoms.
or the, anybody listening in.
That's right. There's no cell phones, that's for sure. But yes, I mean, a wiretap was quite serious back in the days on a landline. I mean, that really took a, federal or some FBI, document to do that. Now, as we see it, what we recently just heard of some another legislation being passed now where the communications corporations now can just pretty much, yeah, capture all the data and give it to law enforcement as they wish. Well,
That's right. I heard about that. That while everyone was distracted with the tragic events of the Boston Massacre, that the Congress was quietly passing a bill called CISPA, the Cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act,
that's right.
and it's essentially the same thing as SOPA and PIPA, which was big in the news last year when Google and YouTube and other major websites were protesting against it. And now, while the nation has been distracted with the with these horrible things that happened in Boston, then they pass it while nobody's paying attention. And I think people are going to be very angry when they find out what's happened and what the government has done.
Yeah, I've noticed lately in my short life of 21, it seems like our rights have always been under the hammer. It just takes a massacre for people to get together and strip away rights. They don't realize what they're doing. For instance, there's illegal mayors against guns, or mayors against
Oh,
illegal
heard of that.
guns.
Yes, yeah, right.
A lot of them actually happen to be felons, and they're getting kicked off the list every once in a while. But I mean, they're working together to strip away the rights, and they're using massacres to it, to do it. In the 21 years I've been
Excuse.
living, I just been seeing nothing but them trying to grab more power, through those the CISPA, taking the Boston Massacre and passing that right there, the Patriot Act after 9/11, you know, it just seems like they're trying to
louder speak up.
They're trying to just take those rights through massacres and using them to their advantage.
As excuse, and, yes.
From the gun debate, it's been happening for quite a while now, since in my life, mm-hmm. and it's always been a struggle for me.
Yeah. Well, I think one of the main reasons that we're having this situation is that lack of critical thinking with the technology that we're getting. In this age of information, it's also the age of ignorance. You're so focused on to what you believe in, if it's libertarianism, being a Republican, being a Democrat, you're not going to get as many outlets as you used to when you had those basic TV channels where you had to listen to each point of view and then think about it. You're not getting the complete story, so you're not going to be informed, and then you're never going to be able to look at that full issue in completely different light. I mean, I think that's the reason why people aren't informed as they are nowadays. I mean, with the whole gay marriage thing going on, Obama passed the Monsanto Protection Act, and that never got any coverage from mainstream media, but because they're so focused on their own little outlet, like if it's Fox News, MSNBC, they're not going to get the coverage or even learn about things that they would nowadays. So I would definitely say our rights are being stripped away because of that lack of, I would say, common sense, multiplying, diversifying your information. Otherwise, we're just going to be as ignorant as the article that was written that day.
Yeah. I think that one major difference that that we've seen over the course of our lifetimes is the massive increase in information. And that my friend has a theory of media that, you know, we've used to have what was called push media, that, you know, all the TV stations, the radio stations were all, you know, kind of centralized and were established, that, you know, those were your only sources of information, newspapers, that sort of thing. And now with the internet and the shift, it's changed to what they call a pull media. So if you're going out and you want to find out about something, then you can find out more than you used to be able to, but only if you're interested in, only if you go out and seek it out. So the massive increase in technology is sort of a double-edged sword. If we can use it to our advantage, you know, WikiLeaks, for example, has gained a lot of attention for their publishing of classified documents and made us aware of terrible tragedies going on in the Middle East that the mainstream news never would have reported. And there's a young man about our age named Bradley Manning who's being prosecuted by a military tribunal, and it's for nothing more than being a whistleblower, something that a man from your generation did, Daniel Ellsberg, with the Pentagon Papers in Vietnam. Mm-hmm. He did the same thing. The government hates whistleblowers, and we want
when they blow the whistle on them,
right? Exactly. And you know that it's a they're rather hypocritical that way.
Yes,
but I really think that it's getting harder and harder for them to hide what they're doing, and in the future, hopefully, there will be hope for us to change this path that we're on, this road to serfdom, unfortunately.
Good one. Yes. I guess for me, when the empire was good when I was young, and now it's still great, but sometimes I wish we were kind of like England, you know, where we've already been there and done that, and now we kind of fade back a little bit. But I still think there's a lot for you to look forward to. I think the future is bright. I mean, we do have a lot of technology that we can count on that can be used for good purposes and not necessarily the dumbing down like you mentioned earlier. So, do you see? I mean, do you see a good future ahead, though? I mean, if we get a hold of this two-party system and try to break that somehow, I mean, do you think we can, this generation, you think we can break out of this?
I think that there is hope, and I think that it's definitely, the change isn't going to come from the two parties, so we know that for sure. That they're not interested in changing. They want to maintain the status quo. I think if we're going to change anything for the better to increase freedom, that we're going to have to look to places that you might not expect it, such as I don't know if there's a new what's called an alternative currency called Bitcoin, a way of using a money that's it's not actually there's no physical money, it's all digital, but you can convert dollars into Bitcoins and Bitcoins into dollars, and a lot of online retailers are accepting it now, and it's designed in such a way that it can never be inflationary. The individual Bitcoins can't lose value, but it'll only be deflationary. Mm-hmm. They only gain in value. And another way that we might see change and more freedom is from a group of people financed by a famous entrepreneur named Elon Musk. They tried the Seasteading Institute. They're trying to they're going to start with large ships and be able to bring people to live on these ships in international waters, and eventually build to their goal is to build a floating community in the ocean, not unlike the video game BioShock. But anyways, the and another similar idea to seasteading is what they're calling I believe they call it micro cities or autonomous cities that I think it's in Guatemala. They want to create a city that's sort of autonomous, that would be have no taxes, and the only law essentially is do no harm, you know, don't hurt people, and that could possibly open up a whole new world of economic development and growth that was never really available to us before, because you know, the government was always in the way. No matter where you go around the world, the government always gets in the way of people trying to grow and enrich their lives. So I think those are some ways that we might see change in the future. I'm sure that innovation through the free market will always keep combating the oppressiveness of large government.
I think one of the biggest things, technology is something that goes beyond cultural borders. I think that's a huge thing that we need to keep expanding on. Without that, we're kind of stuck in this box of religion and what other social measures that we have within that country. We don't see the other perspectives of the world as in much of a light. I mean, even I like this example, Occupy Wall Street, during that time where it was the police against the protesters, I think it was JP Morgan gave the NYPD $4 million to the NYPD.
Morgan Chase, yeah.
Yeah, Morgan Chase, and they put it right on the website. Like, they didn't try to hide it, they didn't try to do anything, because they knew someone would find out and post it publicly. So I think we're getting to this time where things are becoming much more transparent from the side of the oppression of corporations that are doing crony things. I mean, a lot of people know about Monsanto nowadays. Mm. It's just getting past the awareness and getting more towards that action. One of my teachers was pointing out, we're the first generation that really didn't have a huge struggle against our parents' generations. We kind of just slid into it. We never had any huge rebellion as like the 70s
like
did.
We did in the Vietnam War.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't there. And I don't know if that's because we didn't have as much of a physical war, because we didn't see it face-to-face in Vietnam. In Vietnam, we did see it face to face, and we saw war. We don't read about it. I think that's one of the biggest disconnects. And the more technology grows, the more we'll be actually to see war and experience it from emotional level, and not just reading it. I think that will be a huge transition
to
the awareness of the people.
Speaking of war, I'm a veteran of the Army National Guard. I was in for 6 years, and recently was discharged. And
thanks for service.
Thank you, Steve. And so a lot of people don't understand the massive toll that war takes on our veterans, not just physically, but emotionally, psychologically. Post-traumatic stress disorder is a very serious problem. And some people don't know, but the number one source of death in the military is not from roadside bombs or from enemy guns. It's from suicide. And it's because they've run our troops into the ground, you know, asking them to do so much, go on multiple deployments one after another, and it's completely unrealistic, and it's all for what? So that, you know, that Blackwater and you know, the crony corporations can make money over there. So it's terrible, and I think that a lot of people know that, the veterans, it's really difficult for them. I was lucky enough not to be deployed myself. I was in the Army National Guard, so I stayed here in California. But there's a lot of terrible stuff going on, and there's a strong debate over drone warfare. On the one hand, one positive aspect is that it's not placing our own soldiers at risk anymore. But on the other hand, it's a threat to our privacy, to our freedom, and also it's not as exact as they want you to think it is. There's been a lot of innocent lives that have been taken from drones, but that's been true of all war, of any bombing campaign, and there have been many hundreds of children that have died just in Pakistan. A lot of people don't realize how involved we are in Pakistan, but obviously there's Afghanistan, and we've carried over into Pakistan as well, and people are very upset over three people dying in the Boston Massacre, more people wounded, but that is a tragedy, don't get me wrong, but there's so many more people dying every single day in the Middle East, and people, either they don't care or they don't know. And so the way I look at it, we're all human. I don't think of myself as an American or a Californian. I love my country, but I think of myself human first. And I think that, whenever something terrible in the world is going on, I my heart goes out to those people that are suffering. So I think that the America trying to be the world's police is wrong. And I don't think that we can fix all the problems everywhere. When a tragedy is occurring, of course people want to go over there and help. I don't think sending our military is the right answer. So,
yeah, I think you've touched upon the empire and our responsibilities, and yes, we use the barrel of a gun and our dollar, world currency denominated to bring the oil. I mean, look how much we consume here in the United States. That's something we need to look at, and that kind of consumption on a daily basis results in blowback. And I think you guys have probably heard of that before. But I think you mentioned a little bit about maybe the impersonal or the personal parts of war, and in Vietnam it was hand-to-hand combat, and now I thought, frankly, I go, this has to be the last war we ever fight at this point. Back then I thought we'd learned our lesson, but unfortunately, no, we haven't. And I'm thinking maybe the war is more impersonal now, because with the use of drones. And I can be here and operate that drone that's flying over in Pakistan right now and take somebody out. I mean, that's a lot better than putting on my boots and, strapping on a weapon. And I don't know, when you brought that point up, though, I thought, wow, it could be personal or impersonal. But anyway, Vaughn, let's talk about that.
Some good that Rand Paul's doing with that filibuster.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Forcing Obama to say, hey, I will not kill an American citizen without due process. Uh-huh. That was really good. But speaking on veterans, I was surprised to see the House fail to pass an amendment that would let veterans own guns. There's certain veterans that are losing
so
their
crazy.
Second Amendment right just because they're struggling with cash. Does that seem right? It's a constitutional right.
No, it's outrageous. Yeah,
there was an amendment outrageous. That just failed to pass yesterday. On the 18th, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And, they were trying to have it to where the courts would decide whether this veteran was able to own a gun or not. But right now, as it is, the Veterans Affairs, if they're struggling with cash, they're struggling with their payments, then they're not allowed to own guns. Like, does not seem constitutional.
No, it doesn't.
Not at all.
Mm-hmm. Boy, it's almost like back in the old days of Rome. I mean, there was a time where we fed and clothed and paid our soldiers well. And right now, I don't see that happening. And we're asking them to go on foreign soil on top of that. I mean, I don't know. I think that I'm glad that I have young men like you.
Yep.
And the future looks better when when I see that you're understanding and looking and asking questions, and this is all good because we have a lot of work in front of us.
That's right.
It's almost a, what I want to call it, a corporate engineered elections now. I mean,
it definitely seems
except for maybe on a local level, and I think on a local level we can we can make some changes, hopefully.
Yeah, spread the word of liberty.
Yep.
Right, right.
We can get libertarians elected to local office. It's not that hard to do. It does cost a lot of money and time, but we can make it happen, and that's what our goal is. And I think that through our efforts that we can make the world a freer place, a happier and more peaceful place.
Yeah. Amen. I like that idea. Mm-hmm. Well,
yeah. Well, your topic about drones, I think that's, while having foot soldiers on the ground causes a lot more casualties than it would by drone strikes and attack by that, it does create even more of a barrier than it does otherwise. The Vietnam, there was so much resistance because it was broadcasted on TV. I think that's created a lot of the momentum for it. But with Afghanistan and Iraq and all these wars that were going on right now, we only read about it.
Not broadcasted on TV.
Yeah, right.
And, every day, yeah.
I think that's one of the biggest differences between domestic and international news. It's just Boston, Texas, you watch it. Afghanistan, Iraq, you don't. And I think that's that disconnect between the public of here and understanding the difference.
Yeah.
Culture, perhaps, maybe? Is that what it is? Or do we have a half a dozen, you know, media giants that control everything we see and hear, essentially, in the United States?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think part of it is that people don't really want to see what's actually going on. Another part of it is that they don't want to show us anymore. They showed us what was going on in Vietnam, and they realized the backlash because of that. But I think that if veterans really come out and tell people about what's actually going on over there and make them realize that it's not winnable, it's not even our best interest anymore. We're only destabilizing the region in the Middle East. So I think that if we return to a policy of defending America and, friends of all nations and allies with none, the way George Washington intended.
Some of our founding fathers, yes.
I think that that would be a much better foreign policy. Of course, I know it's much more complicated than that. You know, we have a lot of agreements and treaties and whatnot, but I think that we need to change it. So, our foreign policy definitely isn't what it's meant to be. So,
true.
Whatever happened to the Monroe Doctrine? Huh?
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff just trickles away in this country.
True. Yeah.
People forget about it.
Yeah.
It is a complex world, no doubt about it. Much more now than what it was decades ago. I think we have the transparency, or I guess we need the transparency to see that even though it's complicated, maybe by design it's complicated, but we read Adam Smith and some of the greats like Ludwig von Mises and Friedman, and we see that economics and the spontaneous market and trying to control a market is just, you put more controls and more things. I guess the more complicated it gets, the more
that's true,
things
Steve.
Can go wrong.
I think that's about all the time that we have for this episode.
Are
of
we
Sharing
just about
Counterpoint.
Out?
No?
No, we're still now. Good?
Oh, sorry.
Right on.
That was my mistake. I apologize.
So let's see. So we've got, what else, Vaughn? Have you got? I know you had something else on your mind, too.
Our major news outlets can be considered news outlets, but I would consider them also a block because they don't tell you everything.
A block.
And we need to wake up, get some energy. California, especially.
Oh.
And we need to look into things because we're not going to get it all from CNN or ABC. I think California and the United States, we need to have more energy into finding more out about certain things. You can't just click around on somebody's post on their wall on Facebook and read all about it, but you got to really read all about it. You got to look into that and
more investigation. And yes,
one thing my parents always taught me is don't believe everything you read or see.
Yeah, we're good.
Look
right
into it.
Yeah, so true.
Discover, understand it, and then remember it. We gotta wake up.
Yep. Yeah, wake up to liberty and see how we really can live in a free society that doesn't need all the government intervention that they want us to think that we need. They're really superfluous, and there's a whole massive apparatus of government that is attempting to control people's lives in so many ways. It's really unfortunate, but I think that we as humans can transcend that and rise above it, and that we can really improve the lot of humanity as a whole.
I think so too. Yeah. I hope so. There's a lot of politicians who want to tell us how we can and cannot do things.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, sure.
Senior Senator Dianne Feinstein coming up with these bills, you can't use this to defend yourself. But why are you telling me, what if I was in this situation?
Yeah, crazy, huh?
You're not in that situation, so don't tell me what to do.
Right.
Yeah, they breathe a rarefied air up there, I'm convinced. I really, it's just...
We can't have a AR-15 when the DHS just bought 2,700 tanks and a 1.6 billion round ammo stockpile.
So we've heard about that.
Yeah. That seems a little...
They seem to be afraid of something.
Look at that before.
At the hearing yesterday, I heard Dianne Feinstein say, "Come on, guys, we have 6-year term limits for a reason." You know, she wants them to vote against the people because, you got 6 years, you're going to be in there. You can get voted out next time, but you need to vote for this.
Mm-hmm.
She's not thinking for the people. She's thinking for her agenda.
Yeah.
Trying to get her agenda through.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm really curious about is the next wave of politicians, because we have old people like McCain and Reid and all these people who have definitely passed their time
career
in Congress, and they're far behind the times. I mean, the Senate is at least 15 years behind what the public believes.
Right.
So it's going to be really interesting if we have that catch up or not, with people our age going into Congress, or are we going to become much more liberal socially and economically, or is it just going to be socially?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's really interesting how the economy is going to go.
How much do you want the status quo to remain the status quo?
Yeah.
A $16 trillion deficit, and we're the United States, we're the strongest country in the world, but yet we carry that kind of debt?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know.
A lot of people don't understand how much that debt it affects everyone. It's terrible. But
12 zeros in a, is it 12 zeros in a trillion? I think last time I checked.
I think at our last meeting someone mentioned if everybody drew on the bank at the same time, it would be done.
Yeah.
Yes, the financial empire that we've created, we think it's indestructible. And I think the more things that they, I guess the more legislation they pass, really masks really the underneath instability of the whole system.
Yeah.
And it really doesn't take much to bring it down.
I agree.
And now I think that's all the time we have.
And I think that's about it. Well, Keaton, Vaughn, Ken, thank you very much
for
attending.
Thanks,
and,
Steve.
Giving us your input. And we really appreciate it. I'm looking forward to a great future.
Yeah,
and let's make a change. Make a difference.
Visit lp.org if you'd like to learn more about the Libertarian Party.